Okay, this is ABSITE and board review for benign pancreas. Let's talk about anatomy. The pancreas sits behind the stomach and the duodenum wraps around the head of the pancreas. Important relationships to know are that the superior mesenteric vein lies lateral to the superior mesenteric artery and the uncinate process wraps around and under these. The neck of the pancreas is the portion overlying the mesenteric vessels. The body and tail are everything to the patient's left side of the mesenteric vessels. The celiac axis, which gives rise to the splenic artery, supplies blood to the body and tail of the pancreas, and the proper hepatic artery gives rise to the gastroduodenal artery, which supplies blood to the head of the pancreas. There is a collateral from the inferior pancreaticoduodenal artery, which comes off the SMA, which also supplies the head of the pancreas and collateralizes with the GDA. And this could be a source of blood flow to the liver if the proper hepatic artery was ligated near the celiac axis, as can occur in trauma. There is the main duct of Wursung and the accessory duct of Santorini. Pancreas divisum is when the pancreatic secretions drain mainly through the accessory duct of Santorini, which can lead to chronic pancreatitis. If you have to pick an intervention for problematic pancreas divisum, answer with minor papilla sphincterotomy. Remember that annular pancreas obstructs the duodenum in babies and is seen as a double bubble on upper GI. Let's talk about the function of the pancreas. The function of the pancreas is twofold, exocrine and endocrine. The exocrine function of the pancreas is to secrete bicarbonate-rich fluid, lipases to digest fats, amylase to digest starch, and proteases, like trypsinogen, to digest proteins. Secretin causes increased flow of pancreatic juices, and as flow increases, the bicarbonate concentration increases. Amylase is the only oral enzyme secreted in its active form. The rest of the pancreatic enzymes are secreted in an inactive form and are activated by enterokinase, which is on the brush border of the duodenum. An example would be trypsinogen converted to trypsin. Deficiency of lipase production can be counteracted with oral pancrealipase pills, which are known as Creon. The other function of the pancreas is endocrine. The important thing to know about the endocrine function is that the islets of Langerhans are only about 5% of the mass of the pancreas. Islets of Langerhans contain beta cells which make insulin, alpha cells which make glucagon, and delta cells which make somatostatin. Pancreatitis. Break down pancreatitis into acute pancreatitis, which is actually discussed in two phases, the early acute pancreatitis and delayed acute pancreatitis phase. Chronic pancreatitis is present on the time span of years and is a separate topic. First topic to discuss is early acute pancreatitis. Causes of acute pancreatitis can be remembered with the mnemonic bad shit, which stands for biliary source, alcohol, drugs such as spironolactone and Lasix, scorpion bites, hypertriglyceridemia and hypercalcemia, infections, usually a certain virus such as CMV, and trauma, which would include post-ERCP pancreatitis. The most common causes in America are probably biliary sources and alcohol. Know that the amount of lipase elevation does not correlate to the severity of pancreatitis. You should know the Ranson's criteria, which on admission include a high white blood cell count, elevated AST, high glucose levels, age over 55, and elevated LDH. These are all signs of a worse outcome. During the first 48 hours after admission, additional Ranson's criteria include a drop in hematocrit, drop in calcium from fat saponification due to the pancreatitis, renal dysfunction, which characterized by an increase in BUN, hypoxemia with a decrease in PaO2, increase in base deficit, and excess fluid sequestration. I am not giving actual values, but the point is to know that pancreatitis can lead to multi-system organ dysfunction, including hepatic, renal, and pulmonary. So accurate fluid, respiratory, and laboratory monitoring is key, so have a low threshold to place a Foley in a CVP line. Another initial scoring system is called the BISAP score, and it's similar except it uses pleural effusions as a marker for increased mortality also. The treatment of the acute pancreatitis is supportive initially with bowel rest and IV fluids. You should not give empiric antibiotics. If the patient has biliary pancreatitis, you will need to determine if the bile duct is obstructed from cholelithiasis or if the small stones and sludge that cause the pancreatitis have already passed through. Mainly, this is done by examining the liver function tests. If the LFTs are persistently high, then consider MRCP to evaluate for continued obstruction of the bile duct. If there is obstruction of the bile duct, then proceed to ERCP and stone extraction prior to surgery. This could worsen pancreatitis, but if the patient has cholangitis, I would definitely go for it anyway. If there is no obstruction of the bile duct, then during the same hospital stay, once the patient is clinically improved with less pain and less distension, do a laparoscopic cholecystectomy with intraoperative cholangiogram. I like to break down early acute pancreatitis further into branches of complications as follows. The first branch would be acute, non-hemorrhagic, non-necrotizing, non-infected pancreatitis. This would be treated as we described above. The second branch is acute necrotizing hemorrhagic pancreatitis. If the necrotizing pancreatitis erodes into a big blood vessel, then you can get hemorrhagic pancreatitis. This is classically shown with retroperitoneal blood collections leading to a bruise on the flank called the Gray Turner sign and the Cullen sign, which is a periumbilical bruising from blood tracking around to the front. The treatment of hemorrhagic pancreatitis is IR embolization. The next branch would be necrotizing non-infected pancreatitis. A CT scan with triple phase contrast would show no IV contrast getting into a segment of pancreas, showing that this area has no blood flow, so by definition is necrotic. You may also have sterile peripancreatic fluid collections. Not all necrotizing pancreatitis is infected. When it does become infected, though, then this is the last branch, necrotizing infected pancreatitis. Signs of infection include systemic symptoms such as leukocytosis, acidosis, fevers. And on the CT scan, you might see the soap bubble sign, which is when bacteria in the infected portion of pancreas are making small air bubbles. If necrotizing pancreatitis patient has signs of infection and you are not sure if the pancreas is infected or not, an IR needle aspiration and culture may be reasonable. Necrotizing infected pancreatitis should be treated with antibiotics and either surgical debridement or consider percutaneous drain placement, although a drain alone may not work well unless there is a more liquid component. If the patient has necrotic pancreatitis and you think it probably will require surgical debridement, but they're clinically stable, delaying the surgical necrosectomy for a week or two could make the surgery much easier, because it allows it to demarcate and bleeds less. So just mention in a test that if you think there's a low-grade infection in necrotic pancreas, but the patient is clinically doing fine, a slight delay in surgery may be safer. An acute peripancreatic fluid collection with infection, which may also be called an infected pancreatic pseudocyst, would be treated with IR percutaneous drainage, since it certainly would have more of a liquid component. Remember that all forms of severe pancreatitis, especially with the complications of hemorrhage, necrosis, or infection, could certainly lead to abdominal compartment syndrome and may end up needing a decompressive laparotomy in conjunction with maybe a debridement. And don't forget that if it gets to this point, you should strongly consider a feeding jejunostomy tube. Next, let's talk about the delayed acute pancreatitis phase that occurs after the initial sickness but can last for several months. The initial pancreatitis can lead to disruption of the pancreatic duct, which leads to pancreatic fluid collections. Generally, people call these pseudocysts, although early on it may just be called a peripancreatic fluid collection, as the term pseudocyst implies that it's been around for several weeks or more and has developed a thicker rind of a wall. A sterile pseudocyst should have no urgent intervention done to it. An infected pseudocyst, similar to infected pancreatic necrosis, would be shown with systemic signs of infection, air bubbles in the cyst, and these are the ones that should undergo percutaneous drainage with IR. If a pseudocyst is sterile and has been around for 6 weeks or more and is over 6 centimeters in size, it's probably unlikely to resolve on its own, and these are the ones that are considered mature enough to undergo more intervention. It may be a good idea at this point to do an MRCP or even an ERCP to see if the pseudocyst connects to the main pancreatic duct. If it has no pancreatic duct connection, IR for aspiration may work, but this has a relatively high failure rate and you're likely to need more aggressive intervention. If there is a connection to the pancreatic duct, then you could try discussing transpapillary ERCP and pancreatic duct drainage of the cyst. And an interventional GI doctor can also sometimes do an EUS-guided transgastric cyst drainage. Likely though, on a surgical exam, however, you probably will have failure of simple aspiration or ERCP with pancreatic duct stent and be pushed into describing a surgical approach, such as open or laparoscopic cyst gastrostomy. The key portions of this surgery are to open the anterior stomach, aspirate to be sure you found the cyst with an 18-gauge needle and a syringe, then do a generous, probably around a 5-centimeter oval-shaped connection between the stomach and the cyst with removal of a portion of the cyst wall. Send this to pathology to rule out cystic neoplasm. Then run a suture around the edges of the connection. This helps prevent bleeding and it keeps it connected. Then close the gastrotomy on the stomach. If the cyst is not connected to the stomach or needs more dependent drainage, a Roux-Y cyst jejunostomy is another option. The next section I'll talk about is chronic pancreatitis. Chronic pancreatitis can be related to chronic alcohol use. There's also a hereditary pancreatitis from a mutation in the SPINK1 enzyme. Chronic pancreatitis is characterized by dilated segments of the pancreatic duct. This can look as the so-called chain of lakes. Usually there is calcifications in the pancreatic gland from fat saponification and a shrunken pancreatic gland overall. The surgical indications for chronic pancreatitis are varied and relatively confusing. Here are some general guidelines. If the patient has a focal stricture causing pancreatic duct obstruction, they may be a candidate for ERCP and pancreatic duct stenting. This tends not to work very well, does not last very long, and they probably will end up needing surgery. If a patient has dilated pancreatic duct over 6 millimeters, and especially with chronic pain, they likely need a lateral Roux-Y pancreaticojejunostomy, known as the Pusteau procedure. The Frey and Baeger procedures are like a Pusteau, but they also scoop out some of the head of the pancreas, but they also drain the whole thing into a Roux limb. I doubt you'd be asked to know more than that. If the patient has disease limited just to the tail, just doing a distal pancreatectomy is an option. This would probably be more likely used if there was also a pseudocyst or a mass or that was suspicious in the tail. If chronic pancreatitis is mainly in the head and leads to biliary or duodenal obstruction along with dilated pancreatic duct and chronic pain, a Whipple surgery is also reasonable. Lastly, referral to a center that does total pancreatectomy, then they extract the islet cells and inject them back through the portal circulation into the liver, where they can continue to produce insulin, which is called an islet cell autotransplant, is an option, although this is relatively limited to certain centers. That's it for benign pancreas. I hope that helps. There's another video with pancreatic tumors and malignancy of the pancreas, which you should probably check out. Thanks a lot.